What if every mysterious signal we've dismissed for the past 50 years was actually right? In September 2025, a rock in Mars's Jezero Crater pushed us to the edge of confirming ancient microbial life. You probably know about the leopard spots, the vivianite, the organic carbon, but here's what almost nobody's talking about. If we cross that line, if we confirm those minerals came from living organisms 3 billion years ago, everything changes. Not just our understanding of Mars. Everything. Let's assume for the next few minutes that confirmation comes through. The samples return to Earth, the isotopes check out, the case is closed. Ancient Mars had life. Now what? First thing that happens, we have to reopen every cold case in planetary science, starting with the most controversial one, 1996. President Bill Clinton stands in front of cameras talking about a potato-sized rock from Antarctica, ALH-84001, a Martian meteorite containing what NASA scientists claimed were fossilized bacteria, tiny worm-like structures, magnetite chains, organic molecules, the works. The scientific community tore it apart. Every piece of evidence got explained away by high-temperature geology, contamination, wishful thinking. The whole thing became a cautionary tale about announcing extraterrestrial life without extraordinary proof. But here's the thing. If we confirm ancient life existed on Mars, that meteorite suddenly looks very different. Those magnetite crystals? On Earth, certain bacteria produce identical chains to navigate using magnetic fields. The carbonate globules? They form in exactly the environments where Martian microbes would have thrived. The organic molecules? Previously dismissed as contamination or abiotic chemistry, now they're exactly what we'd expect from a planet that once hosted a biosphere. The rock is 4 billion years old, older than the Jezero findings. If life existed on Mars 3 billion years ago, it almost certainly existed 4 billion years ago when Mars was even wetter, even warmer, even more habitable. Suddenly, ALH-84001 isn't a false alarm. It might be the first Mars life detection we ever made. We just didn't realize it. And it gets stranger. Go back further. 1976. The Viking landers sit on opposite sides of Mars, 4,000 miles apart. Both run the labeled release experiment. Add radioactive nutrients to Martian soil. Watch for metabolic gases. Both landers get positive results. Textbook biological response. Microbes eating the nutrients. Breathing out carbon dioxide. The kind of signal that, if you got it from an Earth sample, you'd call life without hesitation. NASA said no. Why? Because another instrument, the gas chromatograph, detected no organic molecules. No organics meant no life. Case closed. The scientist who ran the experiment, Gilbert Levin, spent the next 40 years insisting they detected life. He died in 2021, still convinced he was right. Most scientists thought he was wrong. Then Phoenix landed in 2008, found perchlorates all over the Martian surface. Perchlorates are oxidizers. They destroy organic molecules when heated, which is exactly what Viking's gas chromatograph did. Heat the sample to analyze it. We might have been burning the evidence we were looking for. If ancient Mars had life, those Viking results become a lot harder to dismiss. The labeled release experiment wasn't detecting weird soil chemistry. It might have been detecting the last remnants of Mars's biosphere. Microbes clinging to existence in the soil, dormant, barely alive, waking up when given water and nutrients. We might have fed them. Watched them respond, then concluded they didn't exist because our other instrument accidentally destroyed the proof. Two missions, two potential life detections, both dismissed, both suddenly plausible if we confirm ancient Mars life existed. Now let's get really uncomfortable. What about life right now? Curiosity rover has been detecting methane since 2012. Methane breaks down in Mars's atmosphere within a few hundred years. If it's there now, something is producing it now. Could be geology, serpentinization, where water reacts with certain rocks, produces methane without biology. But there's a problem. The methane appears in spikes, background levels below 1 part per billion, then sudden surges to 20 parts per billion, then back to nothing. That's not what geological methane does. That's what seasonal biological methane does. On Earth, wetlands produce methane spikes when microbial activity increases. Mars has seasonal cycles. Ice melts, refreezes. If microbes exist in the subsurface, dormant most of the time, they might become active when conditions allow. Brief windows when liquid water exists. That would produce exactly the methane pattern Curiosity sees. Before confirming ancient life, that seems unlikely. After, it becomes a leading hypothesis. If life arose on Mars 3 billion years ago, when conditions were good, and we find evidence it existed everywhere in lakes and rivers, why would it all die when the climate changed? Life is tenacious. It goes underground. It goes dormant. It survives. If Earth had a global catastrophe that sterilized the surface, life would retreat into deep rocks, deep oceans, anywhere with liquid water and energy. We'd expect the same on Mars. The methane might not be a mystery. It might be current Martian life breathing, which brings us to the implications beyond Mars. Venus, 2020. Astronomers detect phosphine in Venus's clouds. Phosphine is a gas that, on Earth, only life produces in significant quantities. No known geological process makes it in Venus's harsh sulfuric acid atmosphere. The detection sparked immediate controversy. Some analyses said the signal was real. Others said it was instrument noise. Follow-up observations have been ambiguous. Here's why confirming Mars life changes everything. Right now, with only Earth as an example, we can't assign probabilities. Maybe life is a cosmic fluke. Maybe it requires one in a trillion conditions. If that's true, finding phosphine on Venus suggests we're missing some weird atmospheric chemistry, not finding life. But if life arose on Mars independently, if two planets in one solar system develop biospheres, the math changes completely. Life stops being a possible cosmic accident and becomes a probable outcome of the right conditions. Venus's clouds, despite the hellscape below, have a habitable zone. Temperatures like Earth. Liquid water droplets. If life emerges readily, those clouds could host microbes. The phosphine signal becomes less probably instrument error and more probably biology. Same logic applies to exoplanets. K218b, a world 124 light years away. James Webb detected hints of dimethyl sulfide in its atmosphere. On Earth, ocean plankton produced dimethyl sulfide. Finding it on an exoplanet could mean life. Or it could mean some unknown abiotic chemistry we haven't imagined yet. With one example of life, Earth, we default to abiotic explanations. Unknown chemistry is always more probable than biology when biology is a sample size of one. But with Mars, we have two. Life becomes a normal part of planetary evolution. Suddenly, every tentative biosignature detection gets reweighted. The DMS on K218b moves from probably not life to maybe actually life. We're not just reinterpreting Mars. We're reinterpreting the entire cosmic search for life. Every moon, every exoplanet, every controversial detection gets a second look with updated probabilities. And this is where it gets existentially uncomfortable. The Fermi paradox, you've heard this before? The galaxy is 200 billion stars, billions of planets, billions of years for life to arise and spread. If life is common, intelligent civilizations should be everywhere. We should see megastructures, radio signals, probes, something. Instead, nothing. Silence. The paradox isn't where are the aliens, it's where is everybody. One solution has always been that life itself is the great filter. Maybe the origin of life is so absurdly improbable that Earth is the only place it happened in the observable galaxy. That would explain the silence. We're alone because getting from chemistry to biology is almost impossible. But if we confirm ancient Mars life, that explanation dies. Life arising twice in one solar system means life is not rare. The filter isn't behind us. It's ahead, which leaves some really dark possibilities. Maybe simple life is common, but complex life is rare. Maybe the jump from single cells to multicellular organisms is the filter. Took 1.8 billion years on Earth. Maybe most planets never make that jump. Or maybe complex life is common, but intelligence is rare. took 4 billion years for Earth to produce one technological species out of billions of species. One. Maybe most biospheres never get there. Or maybe intelligence is common, but technology is rare. Or maybe technology is common, but civilizations destroy themselves before spreading to the stars. Nick Bostrom, a philosopher at Oxford, said that discovering life on Mars would be, quote, by far the worst news ever printed on a newspaper cover. His logic is brutal, but hard to argue with. If the filter is behind us, we're safe. If the filter is ahead of us, we're probably doomed. Finding ancient Mars life tells us the filter is not the origin of life, in which means it's one of the later steps. And since we see no evidence of galactic civilizations, the most likely explanation becomes that technological species don't last. They hit some universal barrier. Nuclear war, engineered pandemics, runaway artificial intelligence, environmental collapse, something that almost no one survives, the silence of the cosmos transforms from a mystery into a warning. But there's another angle. What if the filter is intelligence itself, and we're catastrophically rare, not in having life, but in having consciousness that asks these questions? If Mars had microbes for a billion years and never evolved beyond that, it suggests the jump to complex thinking might be the real impossibility. That would be better news for our survival. Worse news for ever finding anyone to talk to. Here's the practical reality check. Finding ancient life doesn't mean finding current life. Mars lost its magnetic field 3.7 billion years ago. Solar radiation started stripping the atmosphere. The planet dried out, froze over. Surface water vanished. If life existed 3 billion years ago, it faced a dying world. Most of it probably went extinct. But most isn't all. Earth's deep biosphere extends kilometers underground. Microbes live in solid rock, getting energy from radioactive decay and chemical reactions with minerals. No sunlight, no organic matter from the surface, just chemistry. Mars could have the same. If life ever established itself in the subsurface, it might still be there. Dormant during the cold, active during brief warm periods. Waiting. The methane spikes suggest something. The recurring slope linea, those dark streaks that appear and disappear seasonally, suggest liquid brines forming and evaporating. If current life exists, it's in those niches. Underground aquifers, briny seeps, places where liquid water still touches the surface occasionally. If we confirm ancient life existed, the probability of current life jumps from extremely unlikely to plausible enough to devote missions to finding it. That changes mission priorities, changes what instruments we send, changes where we dig, and it creates a genuine ethical dilemma. If life exists now, even as microbes, what right do we have to contaminate it? Every rover we send leaks Earth microbes. Every drill bit carries potential contamination. If we send humans, we're walking biohazards. We shed millions of microbes every day. Can't be avoided. Do we risk destroying the only other biosphere we've ever found for the sake of human exploration? There's no easy answer. We'd be weighing humanity's expansion into space against the survival of alien life. Even if that life is just bacteria in Martian dirt, it's not ours to destroy. Let's zoom out to the real philosophical shift. Right now, biology is a science with one example. Everything we know about life comes from studying Earth. One genetic code, one kind of cell membrane, one set of amino acids. We have no idea which features are universal requirements and which are frozen accidents from Earth's particular history. If Mars had life independently, we get a second example. Comparative biology becomes possible. If Martian life uses the same genetic code, same amino acids, same building blocks, that tells us those features are probably universal. Chemistry dictates them. But if Mars life uses different building blocks, a different code, different mechanisms, that tells us life can solve the same problems multiple ways. Earth's way isn't the only way. That has staggering implications for searching elsewhere. Right now, we look for Earth-like biosignatures because Earth is all we know. Oxygen in an atmosphere, methane out of equilibrium, chlorophyll's red edge. But if life can be fundamentally different, we're probably missing most of it. We need to expand our search parameters. Look for patterns we haven't imagined. The conformation of ancient Mars life doesn't just answer whether we're alone. It transforms how we search for everyone else. And there's one more twist, panspermia. The idea that life can travel between planets on rocks blasted into space by asteroid impacts. We know Martian rocks hit Earth. We have them. ALH84-001 traveled for 13,000 years through space and landed in Antarctica. Its interior never exceeded 40 degrees Celsius. Plenty of Earth microbes could survive that journey. If Mars and Earth both had life, were they separate origins? Or did one planet seed the other? If the genetic code matches, if the biochemistry is identical, we might all be Martians. Life could have started on Mars when it was warmer and wetter, then hitched a ride to Earth. That would make us the descendants of Martian refugees. Changes the meaning of where are we from in a fundamental way. Or maybe life started on Earth and spread to Mars. Either way, we're learning that solar systems aren't isolated experiments. They're connected biospheres. Life, once it starts, can spread. Which brings us full circle. If life spreads between planets in one system, it could spread between star systems given enough time. Panspermia on a galactic scale. That might mean life doesn't need to arise independently everywhere. It just needs to start once and spread. If that's true, the galaxy could be full of biospheres that all share a common ancestor, scattered across billions of years and light years of space. We'd be part of a family tree that spans the cosmos. Not unique, not alone, just one branch of something much larger. So what happens if we confirm ancient life on Mars? Everything we thought was probably wrong becomes possibly right. Every signal we dismiss gets reconsidered. Every mission we didn't fund becomes critical. Every assumption about life's rarity gets inverted. And the question that's haunted us since we first looked at the stars, are we alone, gets answered not with silence, but with more questions. Where else? How different? How common? Why so quiet? The confirmation of ancient Martian life wouldn't be the end of the mystery. It would be the moment we realize how little we actually know, how much there is to find, and how the universe might be far stranger and more alive than we ever imagined. The next video will be about more of the latest discoveries that keep rewriting what we thought we knew about our place in the cosmos.